Hello viewer, a very warm welcome to Elimu TV, where you watch and learn. I'm your teacher, Christine Okoth. I'll be taking you through biology, Form 3. For all your questions, for any feedback, you can write to us on our SMS number, which is 4007. You can also write to us on our Facebook page, which is Elimu TV. And you can also write to us at our Twitter handle is at Elimu_KE. Welcome. Our lesson is going to be on classification under the subtopic binomial nomenclature. So this is what we're going to learn in this topic. So first we're going to define classification. We're also going to define binomial nomenclature. Then we're also going to have a brief history of the name or where the binomial nomenclature came from. Then we're also going to look at the general rules that we use in binomial nomenclature. Then we're also going to give example of the scientific names. And lastly, I'm going to give you an assignment. We define classification. What is classification? This is basically grouping of organisms according to their structure and way of life. The basic word here is grouping, then structure and the way of life. So we group these individuals, we are looking at their structures, basically which are external and some internals, and also the way these animals live or how these organisms live. Then, example, we can classify the following organisms into their specific groups. So I have a number of organisms that we are going to classify looking at their structures and their ways of life. For example, I have a lion, peacock, housefly, eagle, cow, cockroach, human, and parrot. We are going to classify these organisms using the two main things we have used to define classification. So these are the organisms that we are going to classify, and we are going to look at their structure and how they live. So by classifying them, all these organisms, they all belong to the big kingdom we call Animalia, because all of them are animals, they are not plants. Why? Because they cannot reproduce or they cannot make their own food. They do not have the green coloring in plants we call the chlorophyll. So this is one thing that makes them to be classified under the big kingdom we call Animalia. Then going down, these animals, they have, we still subdivide them. Some of them we classify them under vertebrates, and some of them we classify them under invertebrates. What are vertebrates? These are animals which have a backbone, and invertebrates are animals that do not have the backbones. So for example, in my list of organisms, under vertebrates, we're going to find the humans, the lions, the cow, parrot, eagle, and peacock. Then still all these are vertebrates, but I'm still going to subdivide them. There are others which are mammals and others that make these organisms to be called mammals. For example, they have the mammary glands, they feed their young ones, they reproduce externally. So under mammals, I'm going to have humans, lions, and cows. Then under the second group, I'm going to have birds. What are the structures that made these organisms to be under the group of birds? Or how, what is the way of life of these organisms that are making them to be classified under birds? So we have the parrot, eagle, and peacocks, which makes us to group them under birds. Then on the other side, we have the invertebrates, the animals that do not have the backbone. Under the invertebrate, we still subdivide these organisms into insects. We look at the sum of the external features or internal features that make these organisms to be classified as insects. For example, insects, they have three body parts, they have three pairs of legs, they have wings. So under this, we're going to classify housefly and cockroach. So by basically doing this, classifying organism, that is grouping them in various groups basing on their structures and their ways of life. Next, we're going to look at binomial nomenclature. By defining this word, I'm going to subdivide to divide this word into three groups. So I have the word bi, then nomial, then nomenclature. So bi is an English prefix that means two. Nomial, it means a name. Then nomenclature means a naming system. So how do I define binomial nomenclature? I will say that binomial nomenclature is a system of naming where organism is given two names, or by using the way we have subdivided, you just say binomial nomenclature is a group of naming organisms by giving it two names. We can also define binomial nomenclature as a naming system in biology in which an organism is assigned a unique name consisting of two parts. The first name has to be a genus and the other name has to be a species. So basically you can say that binomial nomenclature is a group, is a type of naming system whereby an organism is given two names, the first name being a genus and the second name being a species. So what are these genus and species? A genus is a group of organisms that have common characters or one common character. For example, we have the genus we call the Homo. For example, we have the Homo sapiens, we have the Homo habilis, we have the Homo erectus. So Homo is a genus, which means they are all primates. Then we have another example of a genus which we call the Panthera. Panthera, these are the large wild cats in the mammalian family. For example, the jaguars, the leopards, all these we call them Pantheras. So we have defined a genus, so we define a species. What is a species? This is the largest group of organisms where two individuals are capable of reproducing fertile offsprings. For example, we have the reptiles, birds, and fish. So the keywords here are reproducing fertile offspring. So this is the largest group that they can be able, so this group, they can be able to intermingle and reproduce fertile offspring. So we have a review of taxonomy ranks. This is how we classify organisms from the biggest to the largest so that we can arrive at what we are speaking about, which is the genus and the species. So there's an acronym that is going to help us to remember how we rank this organism. So the acronym goes like this. Dear King Philip came over for great spaghetti. So we take the first letter in each word to mean the ranks. For example, the first D means the division. Division is the largest group. So from division, you go to kingdom, then phylum, then class, then order, family, genus, and species. So you just have to remember the sentence, Dear King Philip came over for great spaghetti. So let us look at the origin of binomial nomenclature. How did this system of naming come about? So it was started by a Swedish scientist who was by the name Carl Linnaeus. So most names were given in either Latin or Greek because it's the convenient international language of science. Most of the names that we use in science today are named, are either having an origin of Latin or Greek because this was the ancient language which is still universally recognized for the field of science. So most of the ancient scientists wrote their work in Latin or Greek. So it's either the two languages, Latin or Greek. For example, there are some words we use in our daily-to-day life, but we do not know that they have the origin of some Greek or Latin word. For example, we often use the word vice versa, which is a Latin word that means reverse order. Another word that we commonly use is post. It is a Latin word which means after. Another common word that we use is pro, a Latin word which means before. So Latin is widely spread not only in sciences, but also it has an effect on other languages like the English language. So we look at the general rules we use when we are classifying the organisms. So, for example, I have an example of a scientific name, a Homo sapiens, which is a human being. So what are the rules? Rule number one, the first name is a genus. Looking at my example, the first name, Homo, that one is a genus. Then, the name genus is written in capital letter. the first letter. So the name Homo, look at the H, it is written with a large letter, the capital letter, while the others are written with small letter. Then the second name is a species. Still looking at our example, sapiens is the species. Then the species is written in small letters. Still looking at our example, sapiens, all the names have been written in small letters. Then another rule of classification, the name must be written in italics, that is, if typed. As in our example, it is typed. As you can observe, it is written in italics. Then the last rule of classification, the name must be underlined separately if handwritten. In our case, it's not handwritten, but if it is handwritten, it has to be underlined separately. For example, you're going to underline the name Homo separately and the name Sapiens separately. So we have example of scientific names. We're going to look at each, not all of them, but we're going to look at what are these scientific names, what are these organisms. Maybe we encounter them in our day-to-day life. So the first example here, the main two, we have Panthera tigris, which is a tiger. The word has been written in italics. All the rules of classification have been observed. Mm-hmm. The other example, we have Panthera onca, which is a jaguar. Looking at the names, the P is in capital letter, the onca is in small letter, so it has observed all the rules of classification. Another example, we have Canis rufus, which is a wolf, and we have Canis familiaris, which is a dog. If you can observe, the first name, the genus, they're all the same. It means they come from the same genus, which is Canis. Then the species is the one which is different. The rufus here and the familiaris. Then the next example of a scientific name, we have Galagalas, which is a jungle hen. And we have Gallus domesticus, which is a domestic chicken. So all these, they are of the same species. They are all chicken, but they have different species name. For example, the jungle hen, the species name is Gallus, and the domestic chicken, the species name is domesticus, but they are all of the same species. Another example, we have a horse and a donkey. So the scientific name of a horse, it's called an Equus caballus, that's a horse. Then a donkey is called an Equus asinus. So there's a difference. They are all of the same genus, but of different species. So we have two main rules that we have to observe or we have to remember while we are naming binomial nomenclature or we are doing the scientific naming. So two different organisms cannot have the same name. Organisms have to be different. They must have different name. Then the species name has to be different within the same genus. So we're going to look at an example of Panthera genus. So the Panthera genus contains the main roaring cat types, also known as the big four. That is the tiger, lions, jaguars, and leopards. The four animals, three of them, people find it hard to differentiate them. So these are among the distinctive characters of each of them. So going to start by the lion, scientifically it is known as the Panthera leon. So they don't have patterns to distinguish them, but the males have the mane or the fur around their faces. Most of them are scavengers, and they are the only big cats to hunt together. The lions live for about 14 years, but in captivity they can live more years than that. So that is the lion, which is called the Panthera leo, the scientific name. Then the next group of the Panthera genus, the big cats, we have the leopard, which in scientific name, it's called Panthera pardus. They are the smallest of the big cats. They have a long body, short leg, powerful jaws. They look similar to jaguars, but they are a bit smaller and lighter. The patterns in their fur and rosettes, that is the circular markings in the fur, are smaller and more closely packed. They are excellent tree climbers. They run very fast. They hunt and eat different animals. So that is leopard. Then the third big cat, we have the tiger. The scientific name is the Panthera tigris. So what are some of their distinctive characters? So most recognizable by their vertex on a background of orange. The stripe pattern is actually on the skin of the animal, and it is unique to each tiger, like the fingerprints we have on the human beings. They can swim well and hunt alone most of the time. They live to around 25 years, both in the wild and in the captivity. Then the last group of the Panthera, we have the Panthera onca, which is the jaguar. So they are heavier and larger compared to animals. The rosettes on the fur patterns are large. They are less closely packed and have black dots in the center. They are good swimmers. They are so powerful, thus allowing them to kill their prey through biting their skulls. They have short tails and legs. So that is how we can distinctively characterize, or you can know which of the big cat is a jaguar or a leopard or a tiger. So that has been our lesson. I'm going to leave you with an assignment. So the assignment will be, what is the difference between taxonomy and classification? Then define binomial nomenclature and state why reason why it is important. I've been your teacher, Madam Christine Okoth. Thank you for staying tuned.